I'll just reintroduce myself. I'm Ann Pham, Export Control Officer. And thank you very much, Claudia, for inviting Export Control to join this pretty cool series. So with that, I'll just kick it off. So I'd like to start by giving an overview of what export controls are, because this is kind of it could be a confusing term. So just to make sure we're all on the same page. Export controls are federal laws and regulations that the US government has in place to control the export of sensitive equipment, software, and technology, as well as trade and financial transactions. And in this kind of arena, an export is defined as a shipment, a transmission, or a transfer of items, information, and software to foreign countries, persons, and entities. And so I think that sometimes there's a misconception when we hear the word export that it just means something that you're FedExing or you're physically shipping. But the US government considers the transfer of information. It could be conversations, it could be like, you know, information that you put in an email, that could be subject to US export controls. The purpose of these of export controls is to promote national security interests and foreign policy objectives. And so I'd like to take a step back and kind of delve into why we should care about this, right? Because, you know, we're a university, we're here to do research, we're pioneers, but export controls will touch almost every part of our business, our university business. It could impact research, education, service in the form of, you know, where we travel, our payments, shipments, collaborations. And when something does go wrong, when there is a violation, and this is at the very, very far end, extreme end of the spectrum, there it could result in criminal and civil penalties on both UCLA or the UC, as well as the individual. It could mean fines, imprisonment. So again, that's on the extreme worst case scenario end of the spectrum. And I'll be frank with you, we're most likely not going to see that in our everyday lives, but we might see ramifications on the other end of the spectrum, which could be that we might jeopardize our federal funding. We could bring about some, there could be reputational risk. You know, it could make us look bad with our sponsors and make them lose trust in us, in our ability to not only be stewards of funds, but also stewards of, you know, intellectual property and that sort of thing. And so I will look at the questions at like once I get through more of the slides. So while there are many regulating agencies in the export control arena, the three federal agencies that we will see the most are Department of State, Department of Commerce, and Department of the Treasury. So these are the regulating agencies. Department of State, what they do is they control defense articles and services. These are items that will have the most restrictive controls, equipment, data that will have the most restrictive controls on them. And we should not be seeing or dealing with this very much at UCLA. The Department of Commerce controls dual use items. So these are items that will have both commercial and military applications. And this is by far the regulations that we deal with and bump up against the most as a university. They're slightly less restrictive than ITAR, but again, it's covering items and information. And then the third regulating agency is the Department of the Treasury. What they do is establish sanctions programs on countries, individuals, corporations, or just entities in general. And so what we'll, how this comes up is we'll see restrictions on who we can pay, who can we engage with and provide service to. So the impact will be on purchasing, accounts payable, travel, that sort of thing. So there are two types of sanctions that I'm going to focus on. The first one is comprehensive sanctions. Currently, the countries that are subject to comprehensive sanctions by the US government is Cuba, Iran, North Korea, Syria, Crimea region, and Ukraine. And so for these countries, there's restrictions on virtually almost all activities, imports, exports, even if you hand carry items, financial transactions, services, in many cases, travel. And so some examples that we see in at UCLA, we'll see conference attendance, right? Like it's quite common that we have PIs who are invited to attend a conference in Iran, for example, or to attend an award ceremony, to accept an award, or to teach, do research, that sort of thing. And so for virtually every activity related to Iran, Cuba, North Korea, Syria, or the Crimea region of Ukraine, we're likely going to need a license. And a license is basically written authorization from the US government that allows us or that authorizes that activity. And it'll be very specific. Unfortunately, it does take a long time to get a response from the US government, but it is essential to have that license in hand before we engage in whatever that activity might be. The other type of sanction is targeted. And so here we'll see the US government, so one of the three regulating agencies, they will put out very specific prohibitions on, for example, certain financial transactions or certain services that we can or cannot provide to entities or individuals or even countries, but it's more targeted in nature. And so in those cases, for example, Burma, China, Iraq, Venezuela, and the list is a lot more than that. I would ask that if you're in doubt, if you're exporting any items or information, if you're providing a service, for example, training, or and that could be at a conference or a workshop or through some other means. If you're making payments to foreign entities, that would be a good point to contact export control, just to make sure that we check off all the boxes, we make sure that we're in compliance and that we don't run into a situation where we have to deal with a violation of the back end. So this is just kind of a high level overview of some of the countries of concern under each of these regulating agencies. I don't want to spend too much time and call out these countries, but this is just something to keep in mind. Of course, this comprehensively sanctioned countries that I keep on repeating like a broken record, those are the ones where it is absolutely essential that you get in touch with the export control team, because most likely we're going to need a license. It's going to be a long, and I don't want to say painful, but it kind of is painful process, but it is necessary to protect the individual and UCLA. So what are some of the things to consider as you are engaging in your field studies, field research? So if it's for international travel, number one, are you going to a comprehensively sanctioned country? What's the purpose of the trip? We'll ask that because some services are prohibited and some are allowed for certain countries. And so we want to know specifically what the university business is. And we'd also like you to think about your devices that you're taking and whether they are secure adequately, sufficiently. For international partners, again, is the partner in a comprehensively sanctioned country? But if not, we still need to consider whether that partner might be a restricted entity that could be explicitly named by one of those regulating agencies that I talked about earlier. And we can have restricted entities that are universities. They could be export violators. I mean, to me, that was the most shocking thing, to see universities on these restricted entity lists. But it does happen, and we do need to be careful. Equipment and data. So is the item subject to US export controls? Are we hand carrying items? Are we shipping items? Is there going to be a transfer of data? And then just to draw your attention to the types of technology that would freak us out the most, that would be military weapons, defense articles, anything related to space, or if you're, you know, I know some groups will be using drones in their research, and there are export control restrictions on drones, and so it would be really important to check in with the export control team. Biological agents, encryption technology. We should also think about our sponsors. If it's the US military or a foreign military, NASA, a space agency, defense contractor, we should make sure that there are, that we comply with the restrictions that's in those agreements, and that we're, you know, on the same page with our partners and our sponsors, I should say. And then as kind of the final thing, but a big thing to think about, is in the agreement itself, we want to make sure that whatever we're doing does not have a publication restriction, does not carry a restriction on who can participate. And also we should consider if we are going to be receiving any controlled information or technology. And this is just kind of a summary of things that the export control team does. So we do training and outreach just like this right now. We help in shipment reviews. We are involved in the H-1B deemed export certifications. And so maybe some areas have seen the export control team or my name come up in the I-129s. We are involved in purchasing and accounts payable reviews. Of course, we'll prepare and submit licenses to the US government to authorize you to do whatever it is that you want to do. And the way that we do it is essentially, it boils down to kind of these four things. We look at the item, what it is that we are transferring or exporting or re-exporting. Where is it going? Who's going to be using it ultimately? Who's going to have access to it? And then what is the purpose? Like, the ultimate purpose of the export. Hopefully it's going to be used in fundamental research, because that's awesome. And hopefully it's not going to be used to create weapons for another country's military. And this is how you can contact us. We have a shared inbox, export.controls@research.ucla.edu. And just to let you know, I am here poorly representing an awesome team that consists of Joanna Arias and also Aaron Tabor, who I believe is on right now or here today. And we look forward to hearing from you and helping you. That's kind of what we are here to do ultimately.